Daniel Madsen joins us on Turf Business TV today. And Daniel, thank you for your time there. You're grounds manager out there at Parken Stadium in Denmark. What's it like out there at the moment?
It's difficult times, really. It's the corona, of course, been a big impact on the work itself, the club itself. We own quite a lot, the club itself, outside the football team. We also own a big, a swim theme park, which has been closed down as well. So our budgets, our current accountants for the 2020 was very, very bad for the first time in many, many years. I think it was about -38.5 million euros.
Ouch.
Yeah. So difficult times, but hopefully go two good times now.
And in terms of your team and your budget, has it remained intact or have you had to make some cuts?
No, my budget has been intact. This summer in the stadium, we got the Euros, part of Euro 2020. Yeah. So we still have that like it is right now. The training facilities is still running as long as everything. So so nothing for me yet, but from the club itself, there's nothing called pay rises, there's nothing called investments, there's nothing that way. But for my normal budget, for my yearly budget, is the same.
Well, that's a positive in itself, I think, isn't it? So
definitely.
So how did you end up where you are now then, Danny? Can we have a little chat about your career?
I learned my old boss, Chris Haight. I think you know him as well.
I do, yeah.
I learned him when I was about 12, 13 years old. And then I just voluntarily helped him on midweek and game day, stuff like that, for a little boy. It's a big thing to on game days to stand in the middle and do repairs and watching the games from the sideline and not behind the fences with all the other fans, but being part of the team. That was brilliant, good experience. Did that for 4 or 5 years and went away from the stadium. Wanted to take a gymnasium kind of education, 2-year one. After the first year, Chris came and said to me, I got a contract for you for being a groundsman and parking and a good pay. I said no, turned it down. I said I need to do this second year and then I will come. He came 6 months later and said, it's now or never. I said, then it's going to be never because I need to get this last 4 months with me. And then he came 3 months later and said to me, you are starting 1st of August 2006. So I went in to sign the contract and started under him. Okay. So, nearly 15 years ago, I started in Parken officially.
So one club man.
Yeah. So, and in 2011, I was finished my education in Denmark as a groundsman.
What's the education process like in Denmark for grounds care then?
It's you need to have an agreement with the work on somebody that wants to educate you. So I made my agreement with Parken and we made a training, a training contract saying right. that they were sending me to school and I have to learn to be a groundsman and all my practice work I did in Parken and then I did all my school in the school.
And is that a particular college that specializes in grounds care or is it something different?
Yes, they have taken two schools in Denmark, one in Zealand, one in Jutland, and both of them do education of green educations, which is like gardeners and stuff like that, flowering people and stuff like that, and then also greenkeepers and groundsmen. So I went with a team on 17 greenkeepers and me, and then 3.5 years later, I was done. But the first 2 years, you go together with the greenkeepers. And the last 1.5 year, you go on your special.
Is there a lot of golf out there in Denmark?
Yeah.
So the majority of people through that education course are on golf, are they?
Yeah, they are.
And in terms of what you get at the end of it, you get a certificate. Is that the end of your education, or can you then go on to higher levels after that three and a half years?
I get a certificate. It's like if you get an education as an electrician, it's the same kind of paper. The education is as the same level.
Okay. And after that, is there further modules and courses that you can do, or is it then now to you to develop yourself professionally on your own?
There is some, but I don't think yet is great. We have something in Denmark called week two, which is a groundsman education course where you have like 2-3 days where normally 120 Danish groundsmen will be. And I think if I can just take one thing with me every year, then it's a good week.
So that happens every year. Does that happen at a different place every year? Or does it happen at a college? Or
It's the same place in Jutland every year in like a whole hotel conference place. Then you go there like on the Monday, and then you go home on the Friday.
In terms of how the industry is perceived in Denmark, I think one of the issues that we've got here in the UK, Daniel, is attracting people into the industry. Is it recognised as a professional trade? Is it, you know, viewed in some high regard? What's the view?
The view is that not many know that is groundsman education even exists. They don't know that it's a job you can do. We had a groundsman, what we call a groundsman association Denmark, which is like our kind of union, what you say, that all the groundsmen is a part of. And they try to spread the words also in the media and stuff like that, that we are here, but that we've only existed for 10 years now. Which is not long time, but they're trying to get into the Danish FA, try to go into the players division, the football division and stuff like that, to just mention something silly like every commenter will say, oh, that's a gardener that not done the pitch good, or the greenkeeper. No, we are groundsmen.
Right.
So something little like that, but every little development in that is coming every single year. People are getting a bit aware that we are there. But in the end of the day, also for the education, it is down to the council to choose if they want to make that like college contract with a guy to educate them. Because in theory, it's cheaper for them to just let them work on the grass pitch without educate them. Because they don't really understand that if you educate the people, they can actually raise the bar for the grass, even though if you're just a school or a park or whatever. So that needs to be more focused on that for the future.
You think people don't appreciate the science and, you know, the skill involved in actually getting grass to grow in the conditions you've got out there?
They don't understand. Nobody have any clue what I'm doing, and they don't understand that in theory I could use 160 hours per month on that, or my 37 hours per week, and I normally say, but I'd use 50. So they don't understand that well. They're like, yeah, but you're just cutting grass, aren't you? No, but I'm more than cutting grass, and it's a science. And just look at the weather, look at how everything affects on what you are playing on or looking at.
So what are your biggest challenges out there? Because, you know, my kind of ill-educated view is that you're dealing with very cold conditions for a lot of the year. Is it really like that? Is it a struggle to get, you know, a green surface?
Yes, I'm struggling with a lot of things because I'm a multi-use stadium. So I got one end, which I have no sun in at all. I got another end, which I have one-fourth of my pitch is covered with a roof. I got 42-meter high walls around the stadium tribunes. And the coldness, lack of wind, lack of sun. So I got quite a few things making it hard to be a groundsman at the stadium. But it's a good challenge.
And you've got some toys, I assume, that you can use to help that with the air movement and the lighting, etc.
We don't yet have air movement equipment, but we got 15 of the TLS 240 light systems. We just bought 2 Seagrow light rigs, which has been in the stadium for 2 weeks now. So we are trying to get there. About 2 years ago, we were moved into the sports department of the club. So we are actually in the same, working together with the people that are actually using the pitch. Before, our boss was in charge of the stadium, which also was in charge of the security, the lounges and everything like that. So when I came and said to him, I need a mower or I need a new seater or whatever, he just said, yeah, but I also need something for the lounge. So it was a bit difficult. He was very, very sweet and kind, but he had so many hats on that the grass was not his priority at all. So the last 2 years, we have made quite a good movements. We had last year, we put in hybrid turf.
Okay, what have you put in?
We got the SIS to stitch the pitch. Before we had the Euro 2020, which didn't happen because of the corona. But pitch played well in the stadium. Players was happy. Coaches was happy. Over this winter, we had a corona test center on the pitch. So we changed it in start February. And we use quite a lot of money to change the up and down the root zone down to the heating pipes. So we changed it with a natural turf to start with. So we don't have hybrid right now. But there was a question of how many money we could spend in these corona times.
You're not just looking after the stadium there, you're looking after training facilities as well, aren't you? So what's the scope of the number of pitches and surfaces you're looking after, Daniel?
We got three pitches at the training ground. We got, in theory, we got all of them to be hybrid pitches. I built a pitch last year together with SIS, brilliant new pitch. We got new manager in the autumn. He said it was one of the best pitches he ever played on and trained on as a football player's view. We got another hybrid pitch, which was built 2 years ago. We chose the wrong guy to build the project with. We are now going into court with that pitch, which is not good. It's not draining at all. And then our last pitch is a 12-year-old hybrid pitch as well, with a hybrid carpet, master grass, I think it was called. We got a bit of challenges out there. We got that one pitch we built last year, which is without heating. We only had the capacity of three pitches, and the other two pitches have heating in. So this is like a spring, summer, start, autumn pitch, and the other one is with heating in. So the good thing is that we built that pitch two is called, and it's brilliant and everybody happy for it, but it also, now we need to, because of the corona and everything like that, we need to try to get some more money for changing that pitch three, which is 12 years old, as a winter pitch, because then they have something on the summer, spring and autumn pitch, and a winter pitch to go over to that's as good. And then hopefully one day the court case will sort itself out.
Big part of any groundsman's career at a big stadium like yours is if you get a big tournament come along. So the Euros not coming along last year must have been a huge disappointment and deflating for everybody. You'll have spent an awful lot of time over the previous few years getting ready for that. You're now back into hopefully getting ready for a summer tournament this year. How's it going?
We actually just now starting to clear the stadium outside because the Euros is, we're hopefully getting it. What I was told is that the 19th of May, UEFA will take over the stadium. Of course, they will not take over the pitch and stuff like that, but they will come into the stadium and make everything ready for the first game and 12th of June. So hopefully we're getting there, but of course some of the rumors in the press saying that you're not allowed to be in the Euros if you don't have fans on the tribunes. You don't know if our country gonna open up for fans. That's a bit frustrating, but everything we're told on the inside our house is that we will have the Euros and we will have our four games, which for me will be the biggest I can get. You know, Champions League is great, is top good games. theory, we can get it. We get it every like 3, 4, 5 years or whatever. But the Euros, is we can't get it big. We can't. We're not as a big stadium. We can get the World Cup ever. Not the our country either. So the Euros is like the biggest thing we could ever get, and it's just the whole thing around it is just yes, amazing. Look, just forward to be a part of that and something so big and so many viewers.
So between now and then, are you going to be doing anything different, or is it kind of you're just going to keep your same philosophy?
Right now, we're just going to do everything we can to have a very, very good pitch. And then, we need to look into if we maybe will stitch it or maybe change it to hybrid turf, or if that pitch we got in now, the natural pitch, is good enough for the Euros.
And you're obviously going to have a window to do that, are you? When's your season end?
Yeah, 19th of May. So we got from the 19th, then we'll have training sessions the 11th of June. So we had those 3 weeks-ish.
And are you getting much in terms of communication from UEFA for anything they expect in particular from the surface?
Yeah, they said to me that they prefer a hybrid pitch, but it's not a demand. And then of like all the other stadiums, I got a guy, an extern expert. I got one from STRI that is checking in. He just told me the other day he's checking in like every 14 days now with pictures and everything like that. So
you're doing that remotely, so via Zoom and email, yeah?
Yeah. What we have done in the past, because this is, like you said yourself, this has been going on for the last 5 years. I've been talking to them, and what I said to them 5 years ago is that when you come back next time, it's not the same pitch that's here anymore, because it's a multi-use. We are having concerts and everything like that. So probably the pitch that will be in for the Euro 2020, which is Euro 21, is late in probably February, or will be late just before the Euros. So those kind of testing, as you do in some other stadiums, where you have to go and test every single week or every month and give it back to them, didn't make sense to do it on my pitch, because it's not the pitch that's there for the Euros. 5 years ago, 4 years ago, 3, 2, and etc.
So personally speaking, would you prefer to have a hybrid pitch in for that?
No, I would like to have a hybrid pitch. Yeah. Okay. If I shouldn't worry at the economies, I would put in a hybrid turf.
Okay, so that's a discussion you have to have with the stadium owners, is it? Or
yeah, and we just need to agree, and also with the Euros. But because they only prefer it, and how when we finish, we got 5 games left of the season from now on, and we need to see how the status of the pitch is after we played those 5 games. Because if it's in a good condition, why should we change it all? But it also makes sense: should we just go and stitch it, or should we do nothing?
And at the moment, how's it looking? I mean, has there been less use of the pitch through the last 12 months because of the virus, or has it been pretty much the same as you'd normally expect?
The same. Actually, I would like to say more, because we played our champions play here in June, July, and finished it off in August. Then the new season start the 12th of September. Before that, we have national games. So all the games have been compacted in, and the last game was 20th of December. First game was 2nd of February. And in Denmark, when it's very, very cold, you get very, very big problems. On our last games, directly after the last game, pitch was covered with Terraplast. And then we had the COVID test center. So people went into Parken, had their test in the nose, and 15 minutes later, they know they have COVID or not.
So that was happening on your pitch, was it?
We had like Terraplast down. There was like 18 meter wide, and then 110 meter, and then they just put these stations up with our capacity was about 3,000 per hour to just get through. So that was directly on the pitch. So that meant that we had to change it. So we got the pitch back the 1st of February, and then changed all the root zone, and then changed into a natural pitch.
So growing that in. In February, that's got to be a challenge there, isn't it?
It is. We had 2 training sessions and 4 games right now, and some of the pitches, you know, on the sides look very, very good. The diamond, you know, when the most players in the middle is, it's look pretty rough there. But yeah, we got the light rigs on, and yeah, we try to grow it.
So is there any particular techniques that you have to employ to get a pitch to grow in February, then in Denmark's climate?
When we actually had the pitch in, I actually had the first 14 days with roof on. So we had one league game we played underneath the roof because we had down to minus 20 degrees. And just because I was afraid that the pitch came from outside the field and in Holland, came down to Denmark and make it ready for the game, you know, the grass lays down. And my worry was if I took the roof off, that the grass will keep laying down and then just die off. So I used the first 14 days with the roof on, so it didn't get any fresh air after 14 days. And then, yeah, fertilizers underneath the turf itself. And then, yeah, I think it's gone better than I thought because we had a bit of issues when we got the turf from Holland. Then the first 7 trucks came for Denmark. It was so cold in the night that the first 10 centimeters of the rolls were frozen. So we took it outside of the truck and put a light rig on it to defrost the turf itself.
You had to think on your feet with that one, by the sounds of it.
Yeah. But I think the pitch looks all right after those circumstances. And yeah, we know the turf pitch is always plan B. So we had four games on in 2 trainings in the last 6 weeks.
And it's holding up.
We try to wake it up a bit, but of course it don't look brilliant, but it don't look sad.
And it's playable and safe, and you've got a good surface in terms of stability, yeah?
Yes. But I look forward for the 2 weeks break I got now.
Yeah, with internationals. So what's your plan for the 2 weeks, and what's going to be the regime now to get your pitch?
We're going to put, I don't know what the English word is, we're going to put covers on, but those very, very thin ones, fiber duvets, maybe. I don't know, not duvets. Little thin covers.
Like germination sheets.
Germination sheet, yeah. We're going to put them on next week, and then fertilizer, water, light rigs, and then end of next week is going to warm up. So we're going to go away for this night frost. We should have like 3-4 in the night, and then we should have 8-10 in the day, which definitely should help on the pitch itself.
It sounds positively freezing to me, Daniel, to be honest. Highs of 8, yeah.
That is short weather here.
I'm sure it is. But that's the Viking in you, isn't it? That's it. I think I'd be really interested to know what your view is in terms of coming out of this, where you think, you know, the industry in Denmark in terms of turf care will be. Will it be in a better place, a weaker place? You know, you've had to, as an industry, deal with things. Has it, you know, fostered creativity? Has it meant that, you know, actually people have gone into their shells and become a bit more cautious? What do you think is happening out there?
We had bad pitches in Denmark because of the problem, not the problem there, because of the season have been so tight together. So the Danish FA have made like a working group where they send out to we are 12 clubs in our best league in Denmark. Send out to those to the directors and said we got this issue with 3-4 of the pitches in Denmark. What can we do? And then the directors have to like put in application and say we want to be a part of a working group. And I just was to the first meeting 2 days ago on Teams, and there was me as a groundsman that my boss had put me into this group, but the other 6 guys there was directors.
Right, okay.
So a working group for creating better pitches in Denmark with one skilled guy, if I can say it myself, and 6 office people.
So does that mean the whole of Denmark is following your philosophy now then, or does that mean you're just going to get nowhere because they don't understand?
I think maybe I'll have no chance to get through because this is office people, and I'm more work-wise, let's say it like that.
You need some guys that understand what you're trying to say.
Exactly, exactly. Just something saying that we shouldn't have training sessions on the pitch before a league game. Then the other director said, yeah, but if the pitch is looking good, why not?
There's a reason it's looking good, Daniel, isn't there?
I talking to other groundsmen that said they're struggling with this. Also, my own coach. They want to train all the time and they don't understand the effect of even though you train in July and August, it will have an effect on the pitch in September, October, November and so on. And the directors don't understand. So when you sit there as a one person, and that's only a little part of it, the issue to try to say, okay, if we can make the pitches 5% better by not training at all by law, and everybody just said, no, we don't agree, because if the pitch is good enough, why shouldn't we let them train? And it's like, if their pitch is good enough, then their training pitch should also be good enough. So why should you train in the stadium? And it's just a little thing. But if you can't even get in with the little things, then you have no chance for bigger things.
It sounds very similar to some of the battles that have been and are still being fought here in England and the UK in general. And I think it's all about educating, not just the people that you're directly working for, but you know, the whole football community, I think, in your case, yeah, or the sports community, the value that playing surface has and the expectations that are put on you. And what does that mean if you don't get to treat the pitch with some respect? Then, you know, 12 months down the line, you might have a situation where, you know, the pitch isn't what they want it to look like or play like. And who are they going to come and talk to? It's going to be your door they're knocking on.
It's like TV. It's just an example that they want to make their opening TV line 1 hour before kickoff, because that's where TV normally starts in Denmark. But 1 hour before kickoff, I water the pitch. Then I've been told, yeah, but you need to find space for TV. No, I need to make the pitch ready for the players.
Yeah,
you know, and that's the real discussion.
And are you winning that one, or is it one that you're kind of still scratching your head on?
I won the last three times, but it's an ongoing thing every single time. So last time I said to the TV guy, tell your boss that we're watering here every single time, unless if it's rain. That's our hole for watering, or space for watering. So find another time to do it if you want to go on the pitch. And then he's just replied, yeah, but my boss want to do 1 hour before, because that's where they're going on TV. So then I said to them, why don't you just do it like in half an hour before that? And then it's not live. Yeah, but then it doesn't look good on TV, you know, and TV is money. But I just said to them, yeah, but I'm not going to get chased by my team or my coach for not watering the pitch, because you have to make your opening TV line.
Have you ever switched the sprinklers on just to wind somebody up?
Yeah, I've hit a camera or two, and their microphones, they're putting out like 7 hours before kickoff, or 8 hours when we walking around cut the pitch. I've also hit that with a machinery. I've just kicked it because it's so annoying. They know we're walking around the pitch, working on the pitch. Is that they just come and visit? That's our place, and they don't respect it, and I don't like it at all. I hate that when somebody come into the stadium and just think, oh, that's just the pitch, we just walk directly over it. Yeah, but I don't walk directly into your office and sit on your computer. I think it's the same thing. Respect my work and I respect your work.
Daniel, I knew it would be fascinating talking to you. That's what you get when you're dealing with a real Viking. We get some forthright opinions. You've got a big challenge coming up with the Euros. We hope you get everything you want, and I really hope... you know, they do appear on your doorstep and you get that that career high. Good luck with that and hope to see you real soon.
Thank you, Martin, and you too. I look forward to see you later on this year in Turf Business Summit.